Signore e signori, buonasera. Welcome to New York University Casa Italiana Zerilli Marimò Virtual Home here on the web, everywhere you are. We are delighted tonight to have with us Vittorio Calabrese, the director of Magazzino Italian Art. If you come to any of the events of the Casa, you're definitely familiar with Vittorio that has been our guest many times. As you know, we have a very strong partnership with Magazzino Italian Art, partly because we share the same mission for many respects, and also because we share a wonderful person, the founder, co-founder of Magazzino Italian Art, Giorgio Spanu, co-founder with his wife, Nancy Olnick. He's also the chair of the advisory board of Casa Italiana Zerilli Marimò. So we are united by the mission, and we are united by a great person that is the engine behind our activities. And as I was meeting with my staff in these days, we said, we are really remiss on the front of the visual arts because with the virtual programs that we're doing, music is well represented, literature is very well represented, cinema is doing a lion part in it. But what about the visual arts? So of course, our first to go place was Magazzino. And we decided that we wanted to do something with them. And immediately the first thing we saw when we started investigating was this project that we are presenting tonight. That is visual up to a point. Marinella Senatore, who is the artist featured in the specific project, has a project that has to do more with the sound than with the visual. And we were totally fascinated by the project. And that's why we decided to invite Vittorio and Marinella to talk about this project that requires your participation, our participation as well. I've already contributed a sound bite. I'm not going to tell you anything because it would make an incredible confusion and you would not understand exactly what goes on, but they know and they will be able to explain to you perfectly what the project is, how you can get involved, how you can follow, and how you can enjoy the final performance. To start, I would like to, first of all, to congratulate Vittorio for the superb work that they've been doing in these past weeks. We really look at our colleagues and friends at Magazzino for inspiration. Their creativity, their energy, their liveliness are models for us. So first of all, I want to ask Vittorio, how are things at Magazzino? You started this program Da Casa, Magazzino Da Casa, and of course we are very flattered because there is a casa in it. The initiative you present tonight is part of that, but you also have exhibits. And Magazzino is also open with all the precautions, following all the measures, also to visitors that want to experience the beautiful building by Miguel Quismondo and the collection and the different exhibits that you are doing. So, Vittorio, tell us something about what's exciting going on at Magazzino right now and what you've been doing in this month. And then, of course, we are all looking forward to listening to your conversation with Marinella about this brand new project. Thank you so much.
No, thank you, Stefano. I definitely feel home. Mi sento a casa being here with you. I want to thank you and all the staff of Casa Italiana Zerilli Marimò for the opportunity to speak today and to share more about what's happening at Magazzino, but also what we've been doing for the last 7 months. Magazzino, as all pretty much institutions in New York State and all over the world, closed in March, and we were able to launch very quickly an overarching digital initiative that is named Magazzino da Casa, Magazzino from Home. We produce over 11 programs over 11 weeks, and luckily Magazzino is actually in Mid-Hudson region. We are an hour away from New York, and we got green light to reopen our exhibition space in early July. At that point, we decided to move forward with, I would call it a more of a in-person programming with exhibitions, but also kept the Magazzino da Casa going, trying to engage as much as possible with our community that is not only, of course, the one visiting us in Cold Spring, but it's in Italy, it's all over America, and eventually this entire digital experience that we actually are committed to foster and to keep going helped us to really connect with a broader audience. And that's pretty much like how we ended up re-engaging and getting to a new project with Marinella Senatore. And I'm actually extremely, I feel extremely privileged, and it is because it was has been an absolute pleasure to work with Marinella already in 2019, and we are honored that all our team and our community couldn't like wait to actually have her back in a, I would say, a digital form, or also like in a completely new way throughout the project and a collaboration that is named Cold Spring Soundtrack. I want to welcome Marinella, first of all, and I want to thank her for being with me today. And how are you, Marinella? Ciao.
Hi, Vittorio. Hi, everybody. Thank you very much for having me tonight, because here it's almost, 11 p.m. So.
We're keeping you awake. We're keeping you awake. And
but it's a pleasure. It's a pleasure, really. It's a pleasure.
Many of you already know Marinella, but I'm going to give a little brief introduction to Marinella. Is a multidisciplinary artist who catalyzes energetic community collaborations. She's informed by an ongoing dialogue between individual stories, collective cultures, and also social structures. Her practice is characterized by thoughtfully orchestrated opportunities that enable widespread participation. Everyone is always welcome to part in one of her projects. Marinella studied at the Accademia di Belle Arti in Napoli, and the Conservatorio and the Scuola Nazionale di Cinema in Rome. And her expansive education has influenced her artistic practice. In fact, she works with music, video, dance, movement, photography, installation, sculpture, and painting. We're so happy we were able to have you with us today. Also, because we mentioned before, almost a year ago, it was September 15, presented a project in Cold Spring. It was actually Marinella Senatore and the School of Narrative Dance. We brought the School of Narrative Dance with Marinella in the streets of Cold Spring. This project engaged more than 100 professional and amateur performers from the entire Hudson Valley in a monumental performance. It was a strong and a beautiful celebration of our community. We started from an open call, and as soon as Marinella arrived, she led everyone through Main Street to actually celebrate community with a range of groups, from cheerleaders to marching bands. You can see here parkour behind. There's another marching band. There were classical musicians at this marching band there, choirs, dancers, athletes. There were also community activists. It was a beautiful site-specific community-led project in this way.
Yeah.
And the memory of this project, it's still vivid in our community in Cold Spring. And as soon as we were in the midst of this pandemic, we really got a call from Marinella. I literally got a WhatsApp from Marinella, and it was like, we need to do something right now. And she suggested to me, and then we discussed it more with our founders, Nancy Olnick and Giorgio Spano, this idea to continue a collaboration with the local community in a moment in which we couldn't really be together, and how to fit that in the new digital, I would say, programming series. And at that point, we launched Magazzino da Casa, we really try to investigate the deep sense of feeling of isolation and dislocation that really put us all together globally. I mean, at that point, I think Italy was worse than here, and then, of course, got worse here. Now, I know it's getting very bad in Italy as we speak, especially in the south of Italy. And that's how we launched Cold Spring Soundtrack, which is pretty much a way to meet with our current moment, providing a platform that allows individuals to continue to make art together, but remotely. So we initiated through an open call, and this was September 9, 2020, that really prompts volunteers from the Hudson Valley region and beyond to share short sound recordings of anything that feels reflected of their current moment. At the end of this period of open submissions, which is still going on, Marinella and a composer, Emiliano, an extraordinary composer, Emiliano Branda, will create an original score using these recordings as we receive. The open call that you see on the screen ends on November 7, 2020. You have a lot of things to do right now. Hopefully you're going to go vote or you already did it. But please call this number too and leave us a record. leaving us a recording. It's 845-476-8409. But now that I describe a little bit about what the project is, I wanted to ask Marinella, we're going to make this more of a conversation, I mean, as we love to do. So the project of Soundtrack of the City, Marinella, you know, it's been an ongoing project. This is actually one chapter. I would like to, of an ongoing project, I would like you to know more about how you first conceived this idea. You know, I know you did it in Queens, in Lyon, in Modica, in other cities, but can you talk a little bit about how you first conceived this idea?
Sure. Well, my background is very multidisciplinary, actually, because as you said, I studied cinema and I worked as professional director of photography, but I come also from classical musicians and I shared with the other classical musicians a long part of my life playing in orchestra. So music is very strong in my background, and it's another tool for me in order to engage people in a choral structure of work. So the project of the soundtrack, as you said, started few time ago, actually in 2015, the first time, and now in this very difficult moment where a lot of artists are trying to and are struggling also in order to find a new way for creation, we thought that maybe this would have been a great chance, because it's our responsibility as artists, because we have a social role, and I want to assume this social role very seriously, to find out a new way to communicate. When the time is hard, we have a mandatory vocation to follow up with our work and follow up with the people. So sound is something very poetic and very underestimated sometimes, especially in the Western society, because we are very, very obsessed by images, pictures all the time. But actually, as in the movie, sounds, I don't talk about music now, just sounds, soundscapes, are extremely important in order to create narration. And actually, I realized very soon that making participatory project doesn't mean to make everything but in person or in the street or using the body. There are a lot of other senses and capacities and feelings that can be addressed in the work. So I tried in Zurich, in Switzerland, with the first soundtrack. And it was such a big success, because for any other kind of participation, maybe it's requested more time, more dedication, let's say, and maybe there are people not very keen to, or sometimes it's not feasible at all. And the soft, I call this way, the soft participation, that it's implicit when you just have to send something, it's even more open, because literally everybody can record something on just call that the number that you provided us, and leave a message, leave a note, leave a spoken word, leave something. And it's also very democratic, because everybody has the same importance. You don't have to show up, but you can relate with your personal biography, memory, collective memories, the sound of your house, the sound of your daily routine, or even an idea of sound, because you can even just describe a sound. And this has a lot to do with your inner feelings and with the projection of your life, and also your memory, because you can even quote literally a song or produce yourself a sound. So very, very young people, very, very old people in quarantine or not, far or or not so far, can join it, can step in a relation with a lot of other people that you don't know, but the poetry that connects all of us, it's extremely, extremely beautiful. I can assure that every time we did it, it was a big success because it's very unexpected. As I said, it's sound, it's not image, so maybe we underestimate the power of the sound, but then it tells a lot, and even sometimes more. So even a certain range of public can be included very easily. And that's why I thought that in this moment, I should have not really invented something new, but empowering more and more the platforms that I already tested and that I already use it, because my work is characterized by this strong element of participation, but you can unfold this in so many different ways. And this is just one of the ways. And I propose this to you also because the community is so bounded to Magazzino, and for me, an institution should be this take over this role to be like a reference for a community, a place where you know you can gather, but a place that even you cannot gather, you can consider as a reference for something. It's not about entertaining people, it's about providing culture and instigate and foster the quality of life of a community through culture and through art. Because in my opinion, art must be useful, and it's an incredible gift, it's an incredible language, so it can be useful. So I remember how close and generous to us was the community in our project last year. And I think that it's very important as an artist, but also for the institution, to keep going with the same people and make the circle bigger and bigger, trying to engage more people, but also don't forget the people that are already bounded to the project, to the institution, to Magazzino, etc. And actually, the greatest success of this open call, which is not closed yet, it's that a lot of, I guess, almost all of them, our previous participants, left a contribution, which means that they feel asked again. And this is very important when you make participatory project or community-based project, because when you leave a community, you have to think about, it's not so easy at step in and step out from the life of people, of course.
And I think that was actually extremely successful in this case. I think we, through your leadership and inspiration in the project we produced, we organized with you in November, last November, we left such a strong mark in the community. I remember people saying we would have never imagined we would have march on Main Street. And after all that, I would say hype, that moment of strong engagement, then of course the lockdown and of course the isolation. Yeah. Yeah. And I feel this was a very strong message from Magazzino and from you to a community that was also so generous with you in terms of their talent and then their Absolutely. Availability. And I feel you were able with this project to get the more intimate side of I would say each of us, I would say, stories or moments. Exactly. And also you do capture, and we're seeing as we receive those sounds, a strong moment of uncertainty, just not only for the pandemic but also the elections coming up. So we found so we found that actually the
pretty
community
chaotic, yes.
So we couldn't, I think when we're going to look back at this project, we'll definitely we'll depict a different kind of landscape from the one that you got to know from the years of research before the other one. So I wanted to ask you of course, the situation is different, and of course, you've been doing this project in different spaces. But also, the nature of this project is pretty—it's virtual, so it can also go global and local at the same time. I was wondering if, in your experience, the songs reflect different characters of a specific places, or at this point, we would embrace. Of course, this is the Cold Spring soundtrack, but we've just heard Stefano saying that he's gonna send the Campane from Florence, and we got submissions from all over the world right now. How those like songs reflect different characters of specific area places in your experience?
It's very beautiful, Vittorio, to triggers something and don't control actually the reaction of the people and leave them really free to spread in their own way the news about that. So, you know, there is no censorship in my work, so everybody will be accepted unless it's not illegal what they propose. But also this contamination and this mix of people that maybe would have never got in touch before, and now it's easier because we feel like as a big community, humanity, which is living the same struggle, and we are very different, our culture are so different, but at the end of the day we are struggling for once for the same thing. So actually this brotherhood, which is something very important, I guess it will be portrayed. So that's why I really don't care. Actually, I embrace the possibility that could be embedded into the soundtrack also sounds that belong to people not precisely living in Cold Spring Valley, but they feel called by these unknown people in a certain way. Definitely every project is completely different from another. So the one in France portrayed something extremely site-specific because people change from place to place. And even in one place, there are so many communities and groups. So this multifaceted way to look at life, it's absolutely amazing and stunning. And I can tell you, for instance, that in France, a lot of rappers joined the project. So there, the final outcome was in a certain way vehicled by rap and freestyle. Mm-hmm. So at the end, we had a sort of song, let's say. In Sicily, it was like a small operette, or in another place, in Zurich, for instance, was a chorale, so a big piece, a big concert for a choir. Me and the composer, we process the sounds in a very careful way. First of all, we take the mood from the sound. So there is always something common that you can find that is in common between one and another. So you receive, you perceive as a spectator, when you listen to all the sounds, an initial feeling, and this feeling will lead us through the composition. So it could be, for instance, a classical composition, maybe a symphonic composition, a polychoral composition, we will see. Or it could have also a very pop, strong, even I don't think it will be this way based on what I listened so far, because it's extremely poetic, the material that we have so far, extremely intimate and poetic. And this is very different from other places. I made in Ljubljana, for instance, and there the contribution were very much focused on spoken words all the time. And so we had to play accordingly with that. And actually it was a suite, and it was strongly characterized by the voices. In Zurich was contaminated a lot by African residents, so it was a real melting pot of culture, very often dissonant, but this is interesting for me. So I cannot anticipate how could be, but of course I have an idea so far, and we are reaching now the deadline, and I can tell you that there is a love for the community and for the place that it showed up immediately. And a great generosity also this time. So people open up something of them. And I think that real participation is when me as artist and the participants, we renounce to something that we have in order to give this to other people and vice versa. So we give something and we receive something, but we have to be very open. I have to admit that as well as for the project we did last year, people are extremely open, and they need this feeling to imagine that they are creating something, even they cannot see the people that are doing the same. But it's different to ask to an individual, please give me a sound. It's not that. The generosity comes from the fact that they know they are sharing with others. And the fact that this time they cannot touch or see these people, they can just imagine, but of course there will be a lot of people they don't know at all. So this is very warm. It's a very warm feeling. And I must say that this is pretty unique.
It is very important for artists and community to have that space, and I do want to hope for Magazzino to be the infrastructure to really protect, I would say, that intimacy and that generosity of spirit. I have to say, in our experience with all the digital programming, and of course this goes straight to this project, for the first time through the pandemic, unfortunately, which is a tragedy, but we were able to reach people that we have never reached. People in the middle of America, not necessarily the East Coast, but also Italians got to learn more about Magazzino than yes. Than before throughout all those programs. And it's completely in line with what you're saying. And I have to say that Cold Spring is really facing a moment of change at so many levels, and Magazzino is 3 years old now. So in a way, we are part of that path, and that culmination last November when we were able to take over pretty much the streets and give it to the community fully. It's been a landmark in our history, short history of Magazzino, but definitely the one in town. I actually, now that we're just mentioned a little bit about what happened before this project, I wanted to, of course, many people may be more familiar with the processions and also your more, I would say, participatory performance work that you've been doing over the last years throughout your career. And you work with major institutions all over of course in the US, but all over Europe, all over the world. We were just speaking, you are about to be the Bangkok Biennale is about to open. You did an extraordinary project also in Italy this summer with Dior, yes. But also the Quadriennale in the past. I mean, you're stunning, and you really saw such a diversity of communities throughout your career. I wanted to ask you if you can describe, at least in terms of the guideline, because there is a school of narrative dance there, and there is a method. And we've been through this process as an institutions, and there's been a lot of conversation with you on how to translate the efforts that many institutions really engage with. I was wondering if you can describe a little bit the process of creating an event like the School of Narrative Dance in Cold Spring, and what the final result usually is, more from your experience.
Sure, very clear. Okay, so the School of Narrative Dance is my more famous platform, let's say. It's a nomadic free of charge school, so first of all, it's a didactic project, and we try to foster a horizontal system of education, but even more important, the emancipation and the empowering of the people. So the so-called students at the end are just all of us, including me, and we are called to emancipate ourselves from every possible teacher that we have. The structure of workshop, of course, calls for teachers. In Cold Spring, we worked a lot on movement in many different way and music. So these were the two languages predominantly, but we received also the generous participation of poets, spoken words, activists, etc. So it depends a lot on the local energies that we find. But usually we work with the structure of workshop, but these workshops are just the activation of something. What we try to do is actually to trigger something that is already there, to move an energy that is already in the city or in front of us, for the people that we have in front of us, and they emancipate even from me. So at a certain point, I withdraw my presence. When I see that I activated this process of emancipation, empowering, dignity, celebration of the community, and of course, I orchestrate together with the people that joined the project, maybe the choreographies or maybe the storyline, let's say, in that case, for the school and arts dance, we always have as final restitution a processional performance, and it's exactly what we did in Cold Spring, because for me it's also very important to take the street in a peaceful way and very creative way, so to rewrite in a certain way your own city and rethink about your own space in a different way. So it's different than any other experience that you had in your town previously. So, of course, I help this orchestration organization. I foster the communication among people, and especially with my team, with the community. We try to understand the legacy that can be celebrated, or even the quality and the challenges that maybe people don't know, but they are there in front of me. So I very much like to activate, but then I also withdraw my presence, because at a certain point I realized that the project, the workshop, and everything we built is good because people take initiative and start surprising me without being afraid of fail or to be judged or even to be afraid of me, because I'm the artist, I initiated this project, so I could like or not what they're trying to do. And when I see this independency, emancipation also from me, I think that I'm generating a possible transformative moment for this community. It's very short, but it can last a long time in your personal baggage, let's say. So that's why. And in order to do that, I use the language of the performative art and the visual art. So spoken words, music in every kind and style possible, movement from sport to dance, amateur, no professional, not athletic, or even way to leave the urban, the architecture like parkour, for instance, or cramp. So this kind of urban style dance or movement that use the body in order to create a sort of form of resistance. And then the topics that maybe cultural minorities can show up, or even just popping up, I don't know, depending on what we find and who is willing to join us, but we can have moment of poetry, or even people that don't do art as their job, but they dreamed all their life to have a space and the time to make something.
You know, empowerment, it's pretty much what everyone has been describing and when we were asking about how was this experience, but also you gave them really the freedom to imagine what their own community would be at many levels. You know, like, as I say, we're relatively new to an area that has been changing over the years, and I do feel that COVID in a way forced and accelerated a lot of changes in local communities, especially outside metropolis. You know, like there's a shift that is actually even stronger in this moment of people going up and leaving in a way New York and then relocating in those areas. And I do feel like you were really being able to channel those energy. And, you know, Il Magazzino has a strong legacy in the Arte Povera period. And I think some of your words really reminds me of Michelangelo Pistoletto and yes, all the work that he's been doing. You often mention him as you are one of his discepoli, you're one of and you know, the first performance, which was very different, but in a way share some of the same message, was with him when we reenacted the Scultura da Passeggio in Cold Spring, the newspaper sphere that he prepared there. But I do see that his legacy and his message of community and empowering, it's very strong in the community.
But even, Even just with the mirror, even just with the mirror, Pistoletto taught us that the viewer is part of the artwork, so it's part of the opera. So there are a lot of common threads, no? And the languages change maybe, and it's a different generation, maybe I'm more multidisciplinary, whatever, but in the arte povera we already have this great importance for the people and society. So I, in this case, I feel absolutely honored to work there because it was very inspiring to see this beautiful art masterpiece every day when we were there.
But also the research that we were able to do together, you know, one of those projects, as you guys can imagine, it takes a long time to really get to know the community and to really find the talent and actually really imagine something like that. So I think the most invaluable aspect for us working with you was pretty much that you really forced us in a way to look at community different way, also in a much more personal way, to really be more vulnerable, to actually having a very honest exchange with our own neighbors about what they want, what they may expect from us. I think it's been a wonderful dialogue, and I remember you mentioned it first time and say, you know, the institutions needs to be the one that is vulnerable and needs to open up. You cannot just ask people to come to you.
But you took the risk, and now it's plenty of institutions that want to do the same, but the reality is that it's really challenging. It's not challenging only for the participants or for the artists, because at the end of the day, I also have the responsibility to provide a final good restitution for everybody being happy. But the institution must change a protocol, must also feel every single worker of the institution can feel asked and important as the for the communication. But this is the future, Vittorio. This is really the future. So the instance of the public, the new public that is asking to be more recognized in the institution, it's definitely the future. And this is the way we can bring together past and present and even future. And that's the best, I guess, the best way possible to make a dialogue.
And I completely agree, and I do want to hope, we'll see what happens in the next 2 weeks in this country in terms of like really coming together and working. And I do feel that projects like this really highlights the importance, but also the universal message that eventually really brings us together. I mean, that's why I wanted to ask you, like, how this new form, I mean, this I would say, and it's not a follow-up project, but definitely comes from a strong memory and actually like a positive experience that we had in November. And how does this current project, the Cold Spring Soundtrack, build on this previous collaboration that what we did, especially in light of what's happening right now? We discussed this briefly, but I was wondering if you usually have, this is kind of the evolution that your relationship with the community may experience after a big performance like that one in November.
Sadly, it wasn't this way because it's not only it's always possible to make this, to work again with the same community and maybe with a wider range of people. But I thought that with you, this would be a great experience because you leave also in the people the feeling that, okay, we still count. We are still here and we still count. And this is exactly what an artist like me should pursue all the time. But it's also very beautiful that you can reinvent the participation of the people and you can reinvent a new dialogue and new languages for us to share, plus, and I think this is happening, after the experience of the procession that we did the last year, a lot of people that didn't join the project for a lot of reason, or maybe because not feasible at the time, etc., heard about how empowered and super excited was the experience. So it's also a way to be open to this public slash participant that is there and it was waiting for another occasion. We're asking for when you come back, when you come back. This was the question that people ask me all the time. And it's great that they see you come back. Of course, they see also the institution again refocusing on them. And when you told us about the 12 online project and the satisfaction and the result that this program is you are receiving for this program, let me say that this happens when there is a curatorial vision and when artists are receive commissions that are very specific here and now for this time. A lot of museums didn't work this way and they simply open up their archive or maybe ask us to entertain people on social network, but this is not what art means. Art is not only entertainment, it's also telling about this time, it's consolation, it's also open up a vision, it's giving hope, it's trying to reconnect to people in a moment where people cannot even touch and the restrictions here in Europe are severe and every day more. So people need a lot of things that maybe were underestimated before this pandemic and now they realize how tough is to don't have the possibility to gather as before, to touch and show affection as before, and how is difficult the circulation of information, the schools, how difficult it is for the kids also to stay in a school in such a different way. So this is a time where things are obviously tragic, but it's also time for a great chance to start making things or even think about making differently. And this is the opportunity. This is the chance that I really wish we don't lose, because it's really dramatic. Also, if we don't change nothing after that, it's equally dramatic if nothing changes after that. And if we listen to people, we understand that people are waiting. All your online program, it's something that people were waiting for. People needed that, and artists are there. This is also our role. And so on political and social point of view, this is very, very important and significant. We should be very, very much attentive.
I agree with you, and that was the number one priority when we decided to close down. And of course, we saw the surging of online programs from museums all over the world. But the imperative for us was like, we need to do new content. We don't need to forget about the artists. I mean, there won't be visitors most likely walking in, but the artists are there. And the uncertainty and the fragility of them in the city and the art world, it's so high, and we really need to do something about it. And this project really came out in that moment. And actually, we did share a movie about the performance in November with Marinella, and it was actually the first or the second time program that we did together. It was with Ilinka Barotto, that was the curator of the performance at the time. And for everyone listening, there is actually a beautiful film with the highlights of the performance that is on our website. And it felt so strange. At that point, it was not even strange because it was so early, but it felt so deep, the sense, the how much we were missing hugging everyone. I mean, when you see so many people on the street, and now it seems so far away, but it was only a few months before that we were all out. It was almost -4 Celsius. Remember? it was super cold that day. To the point there was like, shall we postpone? No,
you couldn't stop people.
Stop. You unleashed pretty much like everyone, and then people still asking us, okay, when do we do the next one? That's you really nailed it, like with this like kind of follow up, and I think people really felt they were part of the overarching community. Beyond, I would say, the walls of Magazzino that for a long time have been closed. But I do see here there's a more of a question which is a little bit more technical, in the sense that, okay, so now we're in the for the current project, we are at the end of the submission. So we have another 3 weeks pretty much for people to submit their sound recordings for Cold Spring Soundtrack. And we can you talk us a little bit about the process of creating the song with the composer, with Emiliano Branda? How would you able to translate those sounds in an actual song?
It is very difficult process, I admit, because first it's mandatory for us to kick the sound and to show the sound. So everybody will recognize the sounds. And this is mandatory for me because it's the same in a performance or in any other participatory project. People must see the result of their effort. So we process the sound in three different ways. First, we edit like in a sort of movie soundtrack. So we edit the sounds in a way that is coherent and generates a narrative. Secondly, we process the tune. So we try to create notes, melody, harmonic passages based on the tune of the, or the tone of the sound. So, and then we campioniamo. I'm sorry, I don't know. We rework the sound and we enlarge and stretch and we work it at
sampling.
Thank you. As it would be like a note. So it's like our alphabet for our language. So it's tremendously difficult, but it's something very serious that we do. So people will be assured that first they will recognize their sound, and then their sound will become notes because of the tone, and then they will be even more processed in order to become other kind of sound, but nothing is out of the blue. That's why also the kind of contribution that are submitted and will submitted in the next 3 weeks will lead us to the mood of the entire piece. So nothing is pre-existent or I already think about or whatever. No. It's everything. It's really specific. It's not an easy job, but the composer is very, very good in this. And we did with very, very difficult material, because sometimes you must know, Vittorio, that people even send silence. Yes. So there are people that send 30 seconds of silence. And you have to deal with that, of course, because we don't leave anybody apart. So let's see. I really encourage everybody to submit whatever they think. There is no way to fail or to make something wrong. Actually, sounds can be a lot. You don't have to submit just one if you don't feel so. You can submit whatever you want. It can last just a couple of seconds, or it can be also something longer. It's really, really, really up to people. And you can be also anonymous if you want. So it's really something I hope to trigger a bit your curiosity about it. And of course, there will be ways to share this with a very wide public in the future. So let's see. I have very good feeling about.
Yeah, in fact, we were just discussing how eventually the fruition of this, and there's, in your experience, many different ways of doing it. And of course, I know you are thinking about ways to reach everyone in a moment of extended, unfortunately, isolation in the coming weeks. I know it's very bad in Italy right now, and even here, we do look at a possible second wave coming up. So there are going to be more news soon on that department. And Marinella, before we go, and I wanted to ask you something. I know you're very busy, but I do feel that many of you are wondering about what you're looking forward to and which projects are coming up. I know there are many, But I'm very proud of how many great things you're doing, and I want you to share some.
Okay, so just in the this week I open a show in Rome. On Friday I will open another show in Museum of Prato, Pecci Museum in Tuscany, Italy. Then in November in at Italian Cultural Institute of Madrid, I will open a solo show. After that, we will go to Italian Cultural Institute in Bilbao. Then in Pistoia, again, we back to Tuscany. At the moment in Volterra, Tuscany, there is another show running. But very, very beautiful. It will be also another show at Museo del Novecento in Florence. And December 3rd, I open a very monumental solo show at Palazzo Strozzi in Florence. I don't know why, but Tuscany is in my...
I have to say, 2020 is Tuscany. And
next week, on 29, I will open as the only Italian, together with Massimo Bertolini, the new Biennale of Bangkok in Thailand. And then for the next year, we have already almost 15 show between, we have among them also biennials, very interesting biennials in Europe and abroad. And I keep
working. You are the only Italian in the São Paulo Biennial coming up.
Definitely I'm the only Italian in São Paulo, yes, which is next year, was postponed. It should have taken place in September, but of course, and then I don't know how many other projects.
You are extraordinary, and you have an amazing team of collaborators world,
yes,
which
have.
Makes you present really visually everywhere. But I think your method or your passion really connects us all. I do feel we have. We are your followers all over the world, and I can't wait to see you in person, hopefully soon. I want to thank you again, Marinella, for sharing this time with us. And it's not over yet, guys.
No.
You have other 3 weeks. Go vote now, but also first. Send us
send us some vision.
Send us some audio. You can do that just simply calling 845-476-8409, but also on our website magazzino.art you can actually learn more about the project, and there are different ways of submitting, especially from abroad. I want to thank all of you, Casa Italiana.
Thank you.
And I hope to see you soon. Good night.
Thank you very much.